thanks for coming out. I know your time is extremely valuable, and I'm going to do my absolute best to reward you by giving you what I think. I think tonight's exciting, actually. I mean, if you think about the first session that we did was around profit models and cash flow, and while that's, you know, kind of cool, it's somewhat a little bit just sort of, you know, plain vanilla. And then we talked about time last week, and we talked about time because if you don't have time, then you don't get to do all the stuff we're going to talk about tonight, which is around really compounding profitability, as the slide said. So I'm going to share with you a framework that you can use if you want to just tweak your profit a little bit, or you want to 10x your business. It doesn't matter. This model works either way. And probably the number one thing I want you to take away from today is that this is not about making massive change in your business tomorrow. It's about small little changes done consistently over time that compound on top of themselves to give you that exponential output. I think it's easy to want big results really fast in a business. Obviously, we would all love that. Unfortunately, the truth is that most big results come over time, and it's through doing the right things consistently over time that gives those results. I think it's a much healthier way to go. I mean, it's easy to look at the poster children of businesses and see them just escalate into these massive businesses seemingly overnight. And even those businesses, it's not overnight that it happens, but even if it was, you look at every other business in their industry and they are the exception, not the rule. And it's easy to get blinded by that and think we can go out and do it. Not to say we can't at all, but I don't think a business strategy should be based on the exception. I think you should look at what is more the norm around your business and act in accordance with that. And then if the exponential and the unique happen to you, well, all the better. Certainly don't want to talk down anyone's big dreams, but I think looking for small little singles rather than the home runs is a much better way to approach it. So let's dive into it. And actually, tonight, you guys are going to do a lot of the work, which you'll be very pleased to hear, I'm sure. So be ready to put your thinking caps on, because I'm going to be tapping into you for some of the ideas. So through the slides we're going to look at tonight, I'm going to give you 30 plus specific strategies on how to improve your profitability, and I'm going to give you a toolbox of more than 200 that you're going to get to take away with you tonight. But I'm going to suggest that what I'm going to share with you is by no means the limit of what the ideas are, and I suspect there's some people in the room tonight who've got some good ideas too, so I'm hoping we can tap into that. Very briefly, I introduce my team. If I don't think I've done this in a session so far, Melina, who's really my right hand, she resides over in Canada. We have business interests over there. I lived over there for 11 years. My wife's family is there. So Melina sort of is the boots on the ground over in Canada, but she's also fully qualified HR professional. She is also very creative. She does all our design work, so she is amazing. And Kieran does our strategic communications, and she's in New Zealand. So we're a very geographically dispersed team, but it works really well. To give us some context on where we're going tonight, for those who have had a chance to have a look at the book, in the book I explain about the four keys framework for building businesses. And those four keys are the money key, over there, the growth key, the operations, and the team. Now, I've only got this partially filled in, but underneath each of those four keys are the subsections of things that we need to understand, have a level of competency around, and that's really where our toolbox comes in to apply different strategies to each of those things. So in the first week, we looked at profit model and cash flow. And tonight, we're looking at the growth section. The one we're really going to narrow in on is that six-point growth model. I've got the marketing blueprint up there because I just want to make the point that a lot of the strategies we're going to be talking about are really going to hinge a lot of the time on the marketing blueprint. And we're going to go into detail on that in the Marketing Made Simple workshop. So I want to put that in there as a caveat so we understand that we need to understand that marketing blueprint first before we dive into too much of the strategies we're going to discuss tonight. Not always, but particularly when we start talking about marketing and lead generation. So let me give you a bit of let's dive into the model. So there's three things that most businesses want more of. I think it's fair to say, looking for more customers, looking for more revenue and turnover, and looking for more profitability. Is anyone looking for that one of those three things? Okay, good, couple of you. So they're great. I mean, it's great to want more of those things. In actual fact, those three things are results. We can't directly go out and get those things. There are drivers underneath them that influence them. And just to dissect it a little more, when it comes to our customers, we've got our existing customers or repeat customers, and we've got our new customers. We like to differentiate between the two because the way we would look to either get new customers or retain existing would be different strategies, and that's going to make more sense in a second. One of the principles that we're going to be drawing on tonight is the principle of divide to multiply. Has anybody heard of divide to multiply before? Diane, looks like you've got some information there for us. Can I encourage you to have a stab at what you think it might be? Right. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's a part of it for sure. So Diane said you're using your understanding the numbers around how long it takes someone to pay divided by how much they owe you gives you an idea of the days at how long it takes them to pay. So that would be a metric of dividing out some bigger numbers to understand the drivers. The principle is that when we want to affect a big result, we look at what's underneath. How do we divide that big result up into smaller parts so we can affect each of the smaller parts individually, and that compounds up to the overall result we're looking for. So for example, and I'm going to share with you in a second, if we want to drive profit, we want to understand what are all the little drivers in there that we can target specifically, not just profit as the big thing in and of itself. So if we look at our repeat customers, how do we get more of them, or how do we leverage that? It's all about retention and how do we retain our customers. So we can actively do things to keep customers coming back. And when we look at new customers, we can divide that into two parts. And that is the leads are generating the inquiries and then converting those inquiries into customers. So there's two parts to it. Then if we look at where our turnover, our revenue comes from, it's simply multiplying our customer base by how much on average someone spends. So you might have a customer that spends $5 with you, you might have someone that spends $5,000, but what's the average there? Gives you a simple formula. And then if we divide up to get to profit, it's looking at our margins, which we covered off on in session one in the profit model, and we also looked at overhead. So what we're going to dive into, I'm going to show you this with some numbers in it so it makes sense. But there's six specific areas that we've got a whole toolbox of strategies that we're going to go through that you can directly affect each of those six areas. So I'm going to flip now to this sheet here. So again, a few numbers on the spreadsheet. Don't be freaked out by that. We're going to go through it. It's relatively straightforward and simple. So on the left-hand side there is those six things that we can affect. Number one, retention rate. Number two, our lead generation. Number three, conversion rate. Four, the average spend of customers. Number five, our gross profit margin. Number six, our overhead. So in this business, you can see that they've got 1,500 past customers. And for argument's sake, let's pick a year that in the last year they've had 1,500 people buy from them. In the previous year they would have had 1,500 people buy from them. And in this current year, 60% of those have come to buy again. So they've retained 60% of their customers, and so their repeat customers equals 900. Everyone with me there? So then we look at their new customers. So through their marketing efforts, they get 1,400 leads in a year. So 1,400 inquiries, either through emails or phone or whatever it might be. and they managed to convert 50% of those into customers. So they get 700 new customers. And when we combine those together, the 900 and the 700, we get 1,600 total customers. Now, if on average they spent $300, we'd get $480,000 in turnover. And if our margin was 40%, our gross profit would be 192, with an overhead of 160, gives us a net profit of $32,000. So this is like a business as usual. This is what this business looks like right now. And the starting point for you and something to start thinking about is, how do you work out these numbers in your business? And how do you just start looking at where you are right now? We're going to dive into that in a little while. But what if we start tweaking some of these? And I want to go through and just show you what happens when we tweak them. We're not going to go into the details of how we do that. We're going to move to that in a little while. But I want you to see what happens when we just move each of these numbers by just a little bit. And to give further context, down the bottom there, I've given a really generic sample of what a business valuation might look like. So here it says on the column we just went through, if you applied a 2.5x multiple, meaning a business worth 2.5x what the profit is, then roughly speaking, that business would be worth $80,000. That's a very, don't take that as a general business valuation formula, but just for the purpose of the exercise, we'll just put that in there. So let's say we can get a 10% change on most of those areas, and maybe some of the tougher ones we'll just apply 5% to. So if we go through and put 10% on our retention rate, so retention rate goes from 60% to 66%. And our lead generation, if we can do a 10% there. So we go from 1,400 leads to 1,540 leads. Let's do a 10% on conversion rate. So conversion rate goes to 55%. So you can see here, this is the how much each of these numbers has improved. This first one just is up 10% because it's just straight off that change there. But this one down here that's now got a couple of factors behind it, it's now gone up 21%. And if we keep going, what if we can increase the average spend by 10%? Right now our turnover, our sales has gone from 480 to 606,000 just by tweaking those four areas by 10%, okay? And now gross profit margin, let's just do 5% on that one. And let's reduce overheads, let's go 3%. Minus 3 on that. So with those, hopefully you'll agree, a pretty small little minor tweaks. You've gone from a profit of 32,000 to a profit of just under 100,000 by tweaking those six things, just 10% at the maximum and a couple of them less. Now, if you think about in your business what it takes to tweak these numbers, you might be surprised in how little it does take to tweak these numbers. And you also wouldn't drive in tomorrow and try and affect all six. I'm going to give you an action plan at the end of tonight, but to skip ahead, and as a spoiler alert, you might choose one of these areas to work on in the next 90 days. And then you test and measure different things, see what works and see what doesn't. And then you pick another one in the next 90 days. And if you did that for a year, you would have a dramatically different business at the end of a year. And if you did that for the next year again, and you do that for the next year again, it continues to compound on top of itself. So part of the value in this model is not necessarily, obviously the compounding is great, but to break it down and keep it simple. Because if you just sit there and think about how do I increase my profitability, that's a really big question. There's lots of ways you can sort of go to it to approach that. But if you can break it down and say, okay, where's the greatest opportunity for me right now, and just target on one of those areas and have a way of measuring it effectively, then you can get really, you know, the small changes consistently over time that compound into some pretty big results out the back end. Now, let me give you a copy of that with a blank. So, yeah, we'll start with that one. Do we take one of those? So I'm just handing you out a copy of what's on the screen there, just so you've got a hard copy. And for those watching the videos, you can download it below the video there. And then I'm going to hand you out one more that is a blank. Now we're going to go through this sequentially. We're going to look at each one. We're going to look at how you measure them. And then we're going to start to look at some of the strategies that you might want to think about that you could start to apply. So if you like, just for a bit of fun and to make it a little more applicable tonight, take a moment just to have a rough guess at what you think your numbers might be in your business. I didn't ask you to bring any numbers along, but if you just had to ballpark, and you know, don't worry about it being too accurate, but just ballpark some numbers, and I'm going to get you to play with those numbers throughout the night. Just have a go and see if you could estimate right now how many past customers you've got, how many leads you get in a year. If nothing else, it might be enlightening just to start to think about these things. And realize, actually, I've got no idea. And that's fine. That's absolutely fine. The other area that people get stuck on this model is to think if you've got different parts to your business. Say, you know, I've got one client that does project work and does maintenance work, and they're two very different customers and different buying patterns and so forth. You can either combine them and, you know, just keep it as one number, or you just run two different models. You know, even if the two different models are only for the first part, the retention rate, the leads, and the like up to the average dollar spend. You know, there's different ways you can play around with it. It doesn't have to be exactly as I've got it here. In one other point, as you're just sort of playing around with a few numbers there, this is a model. It's not designed to be an absolute down to the cent specific representation of your business. It's ballpark, you know, because you want to be able to fill your numbers in. It will start measuring the numbers, then fill them in, and then get an idea on, okay, if my numbers are here, wow, that surprises me. I think there's some opportunity there. Or, you know, that one looks about right. Not sure if we can do much with that one. But by just doing that, you'll get an awareness around where the opportunity lies in your business. And, you know, I haven't worked with one client yet that did this and didn't immediately know, oh, that's where we need to start. You know, that's the starting point. Because you don't go through it in the order that I've put it up there. Rarely would you actually. I've got one on retention, but then I've got two on leads. There are very few businesses that I work with where we start at lead generation, maybe with brand new businesses because that's what they need. But usually the place to start is where we started in the first session around profit model, is around margins and overhead, then usually around average spend, then usually retention rate, then conversion rate, and lastly leads normally. Again, every business is a little different, but just understanding what the order will be for your business will be important. And I guess the reasons why we do it in that order is because pretty much for five of those areas, if we just take lead generation out, five of those areas, there's just a ton of things that can be done that just costs zero money. And so why not start there? Let's start with the things that are free. And if you think about this as you go down as like a machine, an efficiency of a machine, if you start spending money on lead generation, which is close to the top there, and you haven't worked on the other areas, you're going to be spending money and not getting the most out of it by not having optimized average spend per customer, not optimizing margin, not optimizing overhead, not optimizing retention rate. So those marketing dollars you are spending, you won't get as much out of them. But if you do all the other things first and then you invest in marketing, now you know every customer that comes in, you've got other strategies in place to make the most out of that. So to be very crude, you know, another way of looking at a business is two reasons. And I actually alluded this to a little bit in the first session. The goal of every business is to get customers and then what? What do we want to do then? Keep customers, and I'll add one word to it. What was that? Happy customers, yeah. I think that's part of it. Keep customers profitably. So we want to go and get customers and then keep customers profitably. And we're going to talk a lot more about the getting customers in the marketing session. There's a lot to dive into there, but we are going to address a few things at the top here. So we've all got our sheet there, and we've got the model I've shared with you. I'm going to give you one more handout before we dive into the details. And again, for those watching the video, all these are downloads below the video. So what I'm handing you now is a worksheet that has got, it's got the six points of the model, with a little spot just on the right-hand side where you'll be able to estimate what percentage increase you think that's going to apply to your business. So as we go through this tonight, whether from the ideas in the room or the ideas I'm going to share or the cheat sheets I'm going to give you, is I'm going to get you to go through and just off the top of your head, pick two or three things that you think could be applicable to your business. So I'm going to share some of the strategies as we go through tonight are not going to apply to every business. So you've got to sort of pick and choose and say, okay, can that one work for me? Or how would that work for me? All right, let's jump into it. Oh, back to here. Okay, we're starting with overheads, as I said. Now this week you guys are going to do a bit of work. I'm going to give you 90 seconds, just to write down on a bit of paper the top three things that you have either tried in your business or you want to try, or just ideas you've got on how to reduce your overheads in your business. All right, 90 seconds. Okay. What have we got? You can feel free just to drop your mask a little bit while you're speaking. Overheads. Who's got some ideas they can share? Negotiate with suppliers? Nice. Suppliers. Okay, what else? Okay, so yeah, call it maximize capacity.
Yep.
Yep, awesome, thank you. What else?
How about computer efficiency?
Computer efficiency, so use technology. Yep. What else? So what was that one?
Minimization of mistakes.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's just call it that. What else? What was that one?
Reduce waste.
What else? What did you call it? You call it better systems or better operational systems? Well, you also said, you said about machinery, so more proactive maintenance could be something as well.
Yeah, like maintenance schedules or
Yep. Maintenance schedule, so reducing downtime. Yeah, absolutely. Good one. What else? Pretty good. Pretty good start. Okay, so this one's an interesting one. Use technology, or your language was better computers, or? Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a great one because, you know, it's a fast-moving world, isn't it, with technology? And unless we're sort of inclined in that area, we may not be looking for it. And technology can do a lot for us. And the entry cost to software and computers these days is a lot lower than it ever has been. So it can be a great one. So let's see. I think you guys got a few of the same ones that I did. So profit first budget. We talked about that one on the first session around really getting clear on the top line, the bottom line we want, and squeezing our expenses to fit in between. So that's kind of like a mentality, that one as well as an exercise. Checking your bills and invoices that come in, particularly if you've got any kind of direct debit set up where people are invoicing you directly or just charging credit cards, it's easy to let those things go. So make sure there's an eye that goes over those. Anyone get incorrect billing from suppliers? No? So accountability for spending. If you've got people other than yourself, or even if it is yourself, if you've done a profit first budget, then make sure there's reporting against it. So people, including you, have to be accountable for keeping the numbers where you've set them to. You guys touched on this one, systemization and automation, the technology piece. And last one I've got, which is a bit of an out there one, but change your business model. So if you've got a business right now that has a pretty heavy overhead, or you've got middle people in between, you know, how can you go direct to customer, or how can you go without a physical like storefront, for instance? Is there a model there that could work? So thinking differently on how you can model your business. Now, so that's between you and me, we came up with about 10 different ways there. But here's a list of 33 ways to reduce your overhead. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I'm doubling up there. Now, depending on where you're at with the overhead picture on your business, maybe you're already running super, super lean. But I encourage you just to have a look through that list. You know, there's a few duplicates there between what we've got on the screen, on the flip chart and the handout. But have a look at that list and just circle one or two of them that you think might be applicable to your business and transfer that onto that summary sheet that I gave you. If you've got one, two, or three picked out and transferred across to your list, just, you know, put a number next to that on what percentage you think that might be able to reduce your overhead. They're all guesstimates, obviously. On the systemization and automation, and we're going to talk a bit more about this when we do the session on systems, but it's the old 80-20 rule. You've got 80% of your business that is just repetition and the same thing happens all the time, and you've got 20% that's sort of the exception and the unique and customization. And depending on your business, it will depend on where that balance actually is. So you really want to get clear on this 80% and say, okay, how do we systemize this? Or, you know, how do we use technology to do it better? A client of ours, Mark, he found that he has inventory, does sort of glass distribution, and he found that they're spending a lot of time just answering customers' questions around inventory levels. So they just implemented a system where they just put an inventory list out to all their clients once a week, and those calls just evaporated. So it's another way, as you think about what are the questions you keep getting from customers. There's probably, you know, five questions that you get the most of the time. So how do you develop an FAQ out of that? Is there some videos or a blog post you can write or something so you answer it once and then it's taken care of? So there's usually a lot of repetition in most businesses, and that's where you want to use the systems and technology to eliminate that. But did everyone get something picked out there? Is there some opportunity there to reduce some overheads in some way, shape or form? Yes? No? Yes? Okay, let's look at margins. Okay, back to you guys. So I'll give you 90 seconds on a bit of paper there. Just write down some ideas. There might be a little bit of double up here with the overhead one. Sometimes these strategies can double up. But how would you go increasing your margins? What would be the ideas that come to mind? I'll give you 90 seconds to think about how we increase margins. Let's look at margins. What do we got? Pat, you said one. You said lower production costs. And there might be a few things within that. Yep. Machinery and labor. Yeah, absolutely. What else? Systemized processes. What else? What was that one, Fiona? Packaged products. Yeah. And what do you mean by that? Yeah. So you're creating more value around a package of things rather than the individual things, and you can often get a better margin in that. Yeah. Right. Okay, good. So you're making one sale versus making three individual sales. Yeah, awesome. Yeah, great. Nice one. What else? Oh, yeah. Thank you. What else?
Stop discounting.
Oh, I love it. Stop discounting. Perfect. What else?
More direct sales, so
don't use a middleman. Yep, direct sales. Increased prices. Yeah, we got that one. Awesome. Yep. But I'll take it twice. That's a good one. What else? So is that measuring your, did you say measuring your advertising? Yeah, absolutely. Yep, measure advertising so you know what's working and what's not. Yep, what else? I think it's pretty good. It's pretty good. Let's see what I came up with. Number one, actually, I didn't have this one on, I kind of did with profit first budget, but you'll see consistency in my number one strategy for each of the six areas. Number one is measure. With the more aware we are of something, the more we're going to influence our decision making because we're thinking about it. So know your margins across all your different products and services that you do, not just your overall margin. Number two, eliminate low margin products and services. So if you look at everything that you sell, some are going to be more profitable than others. Now, this is not always possible to do, or simply just put more marketing effort behind the higher margin services. I remember when I worked with Ian over in Canada, Ian ran a business that did, they did like photocopier sales, they did internet IT support, and they did electronic document capture. Back in the days when this was sort of a new thing. And the document capture was a new thing at the time, but they had salespeople out on the road trying to sell all these things, and the salespeople were sort of a bit overwhelmed with all, you know, what to sell. When we did the margin analysis, it was just crystal clear that the document capturing systems was where the margin was. So we just stopped the salespeople talking about anything else and just focused them on that one thing. And now they could focus, and all of a sudden their margins went up dramatically as soon as they did that. You know, in the way you're producing things, I mean, you know, you guys with the farm, there are different things, margins vary dramatically across the different crops you do. So understanding those margins, very important. Raise prices, you got that one. And I thought I was going to show you the slide. I'll just do it again for those. Is anyone at the first session? Just raise your hand. Okay, so about half of you then. I'm going to definitely go through this. So if we were to, let's say our margin on our product was 40%, and we discounted our prices, because that was one of the things on there, we discounted by 10%, we would need to increase our sales by 33% just to make the same amount of money. Now, if instead we increase our prices by 10%, we can lose 20% of our sales and still make the same amount of money. So understanding that ratio around break-even points and how your margin affects that, I'll say for those watching the video that if you'd like more on this, watch the first video on profit model. We go into this in a lot of detail on how that works. So if you think about that, increasing prices by 10%, if you did lose 20% of your customers, generally speaking, you're going to lose the more price-sensitive customers. And generally speaking, price-sensitive customers are not always the best customers to deal with because they don't necessarily value your product. Not always, but as a general rule. Versus if you're discounting by 10% to buy business or to win business, you have to work a third harder than what you're already working just to make the same amount of money. So there's not too many cases where discounting makes sense in small businesses. Again, I'm giving generalities because I don't want to give specific advice, not knowing exactly who's going to be listening, but you want to, in most cases, you want a small business to have a high margin. You want to be a high margin, lower volume business versus a low margin, high volume business. Of course, technology can play a factor there, but that's a good general rule. We talked about negotiating in the overhead section. I've come up across, I'm not suggesting it's anyone here, but I've come across within our clients, usually a great reluctance to ask for better deals from suppliers. Sometimes there's that fear of conflict. And you know, the mindset we have around that is really important. It's not necessarily the mindset, or it's definitely not the mindset of trying to screw the supplier, because we always want to have win-win relationships, but simply asking the question sometimes is all you have to do. And you'll be amazed that when you ask the question, you know, two times out of five, you might get an okay and say yes. And so it can be pretty straightforward. And if this is an area where you want to develop some skills, I've got a book there by Roger Dawson. He's a bit of a guru on negotiating. But the one I would probably recommend first, which I don't have a copy of because I've only got it on Kindle, is by a guy called Chris Voss. And he's got a book called Never Split the Difference. Fascinating read. Chris Voss used to be an FBI hostage negotiator. So he's taken the tactics that work brilliantly in that field into the business world. And, you know, he's got some great examples of just how to save thousands of dollars on buying a car, for instance. So it's some very simple strategies. You don't need to be a guru, but I highly encourage everyone to have a read of his book. So I guarantee if you read his book and apply some of the things, you will take 5% off your overhead straight away. And we've already covered this one a fair bit, efficiency. But I've got in brackets there, what is your measurement? Like what do you need to measure to gauge what your efficiency actually is? You know, a lot of the time it can be labor, but it could be machine use, it could be, you know, input costs. You've got to work out in your business what is that measure of efficiency and have a way to easily measure it. If you've got to do a lot of, you know, detailed analysis to be able to work out what your measure is, you're never going to do it. and therefore you lose the power of measurement. But if you've got a simple number that you can get to, you know, reasonably quickly, it can be a very powerful way of aligning yourself, but also your team. You know, if everyone knows what the number is you're aiming for, or what's important, it's a lot easier to do it. So now, holding back on the big cheat sheet. So we've only got 31 strategies here for better margins versus 33 for overheads. But take a copy of this and have a look. Again, take a look at the list and circle two or three that could be applicable to you. You don't necessarily need to know exactly how you're going to do it. I'll mention the raised prices and the USP go very closely hand in hand. When you can accurately articulate to the right people what makes you different and valuable, they'll quite often pay more for it. So being clear on that, as I said, we're going to talk a lot about that in marketing, but that can be a really important thing. If you're currently getting price objections, but you're, you know, the same price as everyone else, or maybe a fraction higher, there's probably a problem with the way you're either communicating your uniqueness or the people you're targeting, or a combination of both. Or maybe you're not clear on what your uniqueness is. But it's a really key one for small businesses. You guys okay if we move on to the next one? All right, so next one is the spend per customer. How to get people to spend more each time. And again, there's some overlap with these strategies. They're not all unique and purely focused on the one key. But just take a moment and write down a bit of paper. What do you think? What are some ideas that you've either tried, done, or just ideas you've got around how you can get customers to spend more each time? What can you do to get customers to spend more, either each time they come in or to get them to come in more often? Okay, let's see what you got. Who's got some ideas? How do you get people to spend more each time? Or how do you get them to come back more often? Make them feel good. What was that one? A unique experience. Great, what else? Have good product? Oh, package products again. Yeah, absolutely. What else?
They come in, don't let them out in a hurry.
Right, keep them there. Lock the doors.
Yeah.
So, have ways of engaging. Yeah, yep. Ways to engage. Yeah. The add-on, the cross-sell. The what? A review process. Awesome. Yeah, yep. Yeah, this one, spend per customer and retention, the a lot of those strategies overlap, for sure.
Communicate, give them information.
Yeah, communication.
Quite often personal contact goes a long way.
Yep.
Build brand awareness.
Offer a
after
sales service. Yeah, absolutely. Oh, you guys got lots on this one. I got room for one more.
Increase the price.
Increase prices, sure, absolutely. That one works here as well. Okay. What did I have on this one? So again, number one, measure. Know what it is right now. And the key thing about measuring is, I mentioned it the one before, it's around setting your mind so you're aware of it. But also, as you start implementing some of these strategies, you want to see what effect it's having. So you always want to have an idea on the numbers. How do you measure it? Yeah, exactly. So turnover or revenue divided by your number of unique customers. So the question was, how do you measure this one? Yeah, you just take your turnover divided by number of customers. Not
No.
So unique customers. So if you've got 500 transactions, but they are made by 200 customers, it's the 200 you want to use. Yeah, because we're measuring in total what's the spend from a customer in whatever period you're measuring. Let's call it a year. So you can break it down further and say, okay, how often are they coming in and how much are they spending each time? Sometimes we do that in businesses as well. You mean if you've got different parts to your business?
Like you were saying before, you had a client that was doing...
Oh, yeah, three different...
And gardening.
So yeah.
It's quite difficult to work it out.
Then. Yeah, so you can separate it out if you want, if that's going to be more meaningful. Really, the question is, like, what number do I need to see that's going to be meaningful to me that I can then decide to do something about, and I can apply strategies to it and measure if there's a difference? So that's the idea here. Again, coming back to this is a model, not necessarily the be-all and end-all of how you need to be running your business, but you know, at a very base level, these are six things that we can look at and simplify the way we want to grow our profitability. So we had this one, the cross-sell, the up, down, and the add-on. Who's the best at doing this? Has anyone bought off Amazon recently? No? Known by Amazon, or maybe it's a personal experience, but I bought off Amazon recently, and right even before I've got the product, they're sending me things that go with the product. I just ordered a watch, and they're offering me new watch bands, they're offering me protective covers, all these different things that go with what I just ordered. Targeting more ideal customers. So again, back to your skipping off the marketing session, but for most businesses, you'll be able to categorize customers as A, B, C's, and D's. So A's are your best, B's next best, C's, and D's you don't want. If you've got a lot of these in your customer database, it's gonna be very hard to get them coming back and spending more. So if we can focus our marketing on these ones, then you don't have to work much harder to get them spending more each time. So eliminate discounting, we had that one earlier, and email marketing, which probably falls under the communication. Fiona, know anyone that does good email marketing? Also falls under brand awareness. Yeah, look, again, test.
Yeah.
Test. It's very hard to say you should or you shouldn't, but those sort of things are definitely worth testing. I mean, giving people offers and reasons to do something is the best way to get them to take action, but sometimes there are ways of doing it without discounting. So the classic of adding value versus discounting is a better way, you know.
Yeah.
Make your next order and we'll give you this, because there's ways to package that up where you're giving away less margin, and it can actually be perceived as being more valuable by the customer. Yeah. So I would always look to see how can I value add to an offer versus discount. A client that I worked with for a while in Canada, they'd got into this discounting culture to get sales going, and it was a meal preparation business where, you know, people would come in theory every month to make their meals, but they got in this habit of just running these specials every month, and they just created this discount culture amongst their customers, and so customers just didn't buy unless it was discounted. So I'm not saying there's not a place for discounting. There is in some cases. I'm just really, really cautious of it. You've got now your spend per customer. I did give you a spend per customer, didn't I? Yeah, spend per customer. So again, go through that and have a look. What's two or three strategies that could be applicable to your business? Two or three strategies that could be applicable to your business. And then after we do that one, we might just take a short break. I know it's warm in here. So we'll just take five so you can get outside and have a drink of water or something, then we'll come back. But just take a moment to write down two or three strategies that could be applicable to your business on your summary sheet. And you know, have a guess at what effect it might have on your spend per customer. So if you've got something that is, like let's take your bread, Lou, right? If someone doesn't understand bread, if they just think it's bread, then educating them on why it's special, why they should buy it versus something in a plastic wrap on the supermarket shelf. So you're educating on the quality usually, yeah, or the features or something they may not know. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I mean, there really could be three separate ones, but yeah. So educate on full range. I mean, I learned this one when I was running our printing company in Sydney. We'd have people come in to do a press check on something, and they come to our foyer area where we have samples of all our different work, and they go, oh, you do this, and you do this, and you do this. And we go, well, yeah, didn't you know that? But we'd done a horrible job of explaining to them all the different things that we did. So, you know, if... Sometimes as business owners, we know our business inside out and we know everything it can do and everything we can offer, but we don't always do the greatest job of educating others on that. So folks, let's just take five and get up, stretch your legs, get outside if you like, get a glass of water, and then we'll come back and we'll get through the other three components of our 6-point model. Okay, is everyone ready? We all ready to go? I did want to mention the discounting your prices and increasing that I talked about. I threw that little math equation up there of this one here, 40%, if your margin was 40%, et cetera, et cetera. There's a handout which I'll link to underneath this video as well. We covered it in the first session on profit model. I gave a handout on if you know, you've got different margins across the top and what happens if you discount your price by a different amount, the amount you have to increase your sales, a whole matrix there so you can see where your business would fall into. I haven't got the handouts here tonight, but you can download that on the session one notes. It's all there. Yes, very, very sobering to understand how much harder you got to work if you want to discount. Okay, so let's jump into the retention. Again, this one's very closely linked to what we just did, the spend per customer. But just take a moment on your bit of paper there and write down a couple of ideas on what you can do to retain customers. What can you do to stop them going somewhere else? Okay. Who's got some ideas for retaining customers? Great service. Great service? Nice. Be nice. Be nice. Yes. Yes. Well, you say that, but you know, be nice. Make them feel special. Hmm. Over deliver. What was that one, Fiona?
Develop a retention plan.
Have it, yeah, retain. Yeah, absolutely.
Would we have a measure
Awesome. All right, number one, measure. Be consistent, yes. Yep. Well, consistent in a lot of ways. Yeah, consistent how you answer the phone even. Yeah, people love consistency. Have a suite of add-on services. Suite of add-ons. Yeah, follow-up. That's a really important one. It's what was that? Priority service? Yeah. Develop new services, yeah. New services. Yep, I'm going to just put innovate next to that. I know it's a very overused term, but keep improving.
A referral bonus.
Oh, referral bonus. Okay, retention, we'll put it here, but I'd almost put that down as a lead generation. Yeah, absolutely. Yep. Yep, cool.
Well,
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So sending an email to one customer or asking a referral to the next one. I'm repeating it so the people on the camera can hear it. awesome. You guys are good at this one. Anything else? Yeah, personal connection / relationship. Personal connection.
Survey.
Yeah, survey. Yeah, seek feedback. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, cool. I mean, you look at all of those and they're not sort of just tick off and do. They're like ever improving on all of these things. But let's see. I think you guys got most of what I had written down. Number one, measure. Thank you, Diane. And there is a tool which, if you've read the book, you may have downloaded it from our website, a simple tool to help you look at what your retention rate is. It's a really important measure because it is, well, there's lots of different stats out there, but needless to say, it's much easier to keep a customer than to go and get a new one. Once you've already spent the time and effort of getting a customer, if you nurture that relationship, it can pay for a long time. So, you know, if we look at this example here, and this is very simply just looking at the total number of unique customers and the new customers for that period, and that gives you your existing customers. And then the tool just simply works out, you know, the percentage of retention rate period over period. But if you look at this example and you look at the number of unique customers, period 1 through 6, it's generally going up, right? So it'd be easy to sit in that business and go, look, we've got more customers coming in. This is awesome. And their sales may actually be going up. But you look at their retention rate. Their retention rate is actually going down. So they could be just spending more on marketing and getting more customers in, but not retaining them. And so you gotta make sure you're measuring the right thing because you can be deluded into thinking things are really great when I think this is a true measure of a business is retention rate. Particularly, it might depend on the business. You might say, what if you're a funeral parlor? What's that? Yeah. Right.
So it would be very difficult for somebody to...
Yeah. No, absolutely. So the point is that depending on the business, if you're a tourist business and it's just people coming through, they come once, they're never going to come again. Yeah, absolutely. But you might find that within your segment, a percentage do. And so the band you might be aiming for might be 10 to 20%. That might be your measure. As long as we stay between 10 and 20%, we know we're in the ballpark. So I don't think the measure is ever to try and make it 100. Obviously, that'd be great if you could. But it's more about the trend. It's about the trend. And you want to know that your trend is going at least holding steady or increasing. So that, I mean, if your trend is going down, I wouldn't be putting more money into marketing. I'd be putting more effort into retention, right? So it's just knowing where to put the focus and the effort. So that's that. The point down the bottom here just talks about what period do you measure? And it really does depend on what the buying cycle is of your customer. If you got someone, that's right, if you got someone that buys 4 or 5 times a year, if you measure quarterly, you'll probably capture some reasonably accurate numbers. But if you've got someone that buys once every 3 years, measuring quarterly is not going to give you much, right? You might need to measure over 4 years, which can be hard to do. But you've got to work out what's the formula that's going to give you some meaningful information for your business that you can start to get some insights. This sort of begs the question, and you know, Diane, you're so good at putting the number one up there, but I would talk about measuring a lot. To measure, you need to have the data. And to have the data means you need to have the systems that can capture the data. So if you haven't got that right now, don't be overwhelmed by that and feel like you've got to go out and be able to start measuring everything. But have awareness and say, okay, what could we start to improve there? Because numbers can be, while they're not everything in a business, they're very insightful. And they can help you make quick and easy decisions rather than gut-filled decisions, which sometimes can be good too. But often, like in this example, you know, the business can be growing, but actually have an underlying problem that's going to come back and bite them in the butt. So the numbers, if you can find a way to get the numbers out of your business simply and easily, and the two major tools for that are a good accounting system and a good CRM. If you've got a good CRM, that's customer relationship management, where you've got all your customer data in, and that is linked up with your accounting system so you know where the transactions are coming from, you can usually do some pretty simple analysis that can get you most of these numbers. It doesn't have to be complex. So you guys had this one, show you care, show them the love. Nothing beats that one. That would be the number one business strategy for customer retention, is making people, you guys had it, be nice, great service, make them feel special. Now that's easy when it's you, right? When you're the business owner. What happens when you've got a team, right? You've got other people who are interacting with the customer. So now it starts to become about culture in the business. It starts to become about recruitment. It starts to become around leadership and training. It starts to become around establishing your values in the business. So different things we're going to talk more about around team and around systems. Because you can systemize this. You can't necessarily systemize the emotion behind it, but you can, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So building community and loyalty programs, the more someone feels a part of something, the more they want to stay with it. And so you've got to find what that could be for you. What do people feel like they want to be a part of? If you've got something like Harley Davidson has this just, you know, they're probably not a brand or a business that we're all going to aspire to, but this company has customers that tattoo its logo on their body because they just love there's something about a Harley Davidson. I haven't got one, I'm not sure what it is, but I know people that do that, they're crazy about it. So there's a community of these people. You know, these people nod to each other when they go on the street and they see someone else riding a Harley Davidson. And you know, the classic loyalty, how do you get people engaged and how do you reward them for being good customers? That could be special events that you run for customers only, or it could be, you know, the buy 9, get the 10th free type thing. It can range in between. Customize the experience, your customer experience pathway. If you think about what happens when someone first engages with your company through to the life of them being a customer, there's lots of little touch points in there. From the moment they call your company or they jump on your website, when they pick the goods up or they come and do whatever, they're all touch points. And they're opportunities for you to make an impression and make a mark, including when you screw up and you make mistakes. That's another touch point, another opportunity to stand out. I've got an example here for you. CD Baby was founded by a guy called Derek Sivers. And it was a bit of an accidental company that he started. He was an artist and he wanted to be able to sell his own CDs rather than go through a recording studio. And this is, you know, 20 years ago when he did this. So he developed his own way of selling his CDs. And before long, other artists were saying, hey, can you sell mine as well? And next thing you know, he had this online CD selling business. And when you ordered from CD Baby, you got a little note that said, your order is shipped today. Please let us know if it doesn't arrive. Thank you for your business. And one day, Derek was sitting there and sort of just thinking about this and thinking about, well, how could I make that a little more special? And they rewrote it. And I'm going to read out to you what it now says. Your CD has been gently taken from our CD Baby shelves with sterilized, contamination-free gloves and placed onto a satin pillow. A team of 50 employees inspected your CD and polished it to make sure it was in the best possible condition before mailing. Our packaging specialist from Japan lit a candle and a hush fell over the crowd as he put your CD into the finest gold-lined box that money can buy. We've all had a wonderful celebration afterwards, and the whole party marched down the street to the post office where the entire town of Portland waved bon voyage to your package. It's on its way to you in our private CD Baby jet on this day, Friday, 6th of June. I hope you had a wonderful time shopping at CD Baby. We sure did. Your picture is on our wall as Customer of the Year. We're all exhausted but can't wait for you to come back to cdbaby.com. I mean, that would be an experience if you received that. But that's just one little touch point. That was someone writing an email. I mean, this stuff is more common these days. This was 20 years ago. But what are the little touch points where you can just inject a little bit of personality, a little bit of care, a little bit of love? If you dissect your customer pathway, you'll find lots of those little touch points. And often doesn't take a lot of effort, just like Derek did on his... And to give you an idea on how powerful this is, if you Google, again, this was... 20 years ago when it happened, this stuff's a lot more common today. But if you Google right now CD Baby thank you email, and you see the internet proliferated with this stuff. So it not only made a mark on that customer, but it went viral. And you think about that from a marketing perspective in terms of the awareness around CD Baby. You guys are onto it. I mean, it's about... this, you know, the referral bonus, you may, you know, when you do this stuff really well, you often don't need to offer referral bonuses because people just refer to you anyway because they're so enamored by the experience of doing business with you. That's the goal. Now, the other point that I'll make around this is that, and I talk about this in our marketing session about the ideal customer, because the way you craft your customer pathway or customer experience pathway will be a match for your ideal customer. It won't be a match for everyone. Some people would get this and go, what a load of rubbish. Why are they writing that? It's just junk. They don't mean it, right? But that's not CD Baby's ideal customer. So you don't need to worry about those people. You get really clear on who your ideal customer is and you can craft an experience for them that just lights them up. Then all of a sudden now you've got free marketing through word of mouth and referral and obviously retention, because that's what we're talking about here. Number five, after sale follow-up, someone, you guys had that one as well, the follow-up. Does anybody, now this is not the clearest picture, but does anyone recognize this face? I would be very surprised if you did. This is Joe Girard. Has anyone heard of Joe Girard? You've heard the name? So Joe Girard has the Guinness Book of Records for selling the most amount of cars. So he's a car salesman, Guinness Book of Records. So in 15 years, Joe sold 13,001 cars. Now, if you break that down to a daily number, that is astronomical. So Joe did many things, but one of the things that he did was that if you bought a car from Joe Girard, he sent you a postcard every month that you or he were alive. So in January, be Happy New Year, I like you, Joe Girard. In February, Happy Valentine's Day, I like you, Joe Girard. In March, Happy St. Patrick's Day, I like you, Joe Girard. Every day of the month. Now, judge that as you will, but the numbers speak for themselves, but if you just think about that from a strategy point of view, so Joe spent, what, a dollar something on a postcard? It was a dollar something for postage. Let's say all up it was a $5 experience, so 12 cards a year is $60. What if only one in three people come back? It's $180 to get a repeat customer. So assuming, you know, they had a great strategy as well, but keeping in touch, right? Keeping in touch, having those ways to keep people coming back is important. Conversion rate. Okay. Conversion rate. One of my favorites. I love conversion rate because it's often very, very untapped. And there's so many things we can do for free that just increases this number. So let's take a moment. Let's take 90 seconds. Oh, yeah, thank you. Right. Retention strategy. Sorry, we didn't finish up there. I think you got the best ones anyway. There's probably some tweaking. You know, if you've got a business that doesn't have direct relationship with your end user, it's a good idea to try and think of ways to create that. Like if you're selling through another person and so you don't have the contact details of your end user, you know, developing ways of giving people a reason to engage with you and share their information with you is great, because then you do get a direct line of communication. Like we talked before about offers, you know, if you... You know, you see this. You see the big brands do this all the time. If you go buy a bottle of Weet-Bix or whatever, they've got competitions they run and things to get you to give you their details so they can learn more about you and market to you ongoing. So you've got to be creative in the way you do it, and it's got to be valuable. There's got to be something in it for your customer. But it's very worthwhile to think about, how do I create that direct relationship with my customer versus relying on someone else to have that relationship? Because if you don't own the relationship, then you've lost a little bit of power, like, because other people can do different things with your product or your service that is out of your control. You can't always fully mitigate that depending on your business model, but being aware of that can be, and having some strategies in place can be a good idea. So now with your retention rate strategies, again, pick two or three on your list there and put them on your cheat sheet or your summary page. So what was that, Fiona? Call cycling. So if you know that, example, an insurance company, before the policies come up for renewal, have a schedule to call them. So there's a cycle that which you call to stay in touch. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, same sort of thing. Yep. Yep. Yeah, a client of mine who's a PR company, they would always make sure, while clients are always month to month, they'd always make sure they've got 6 months worth of plan ahead, and always every quarter going, doing the next 6 months ahead. So always got vision, future vision. Okay, if you got a couple picked out there, just write down a percentage on what you think that might do for you. And the reason you're doing that is, one, so when you do get your numbers, you can plug in a few of these and play around with the percentage increases. You'll be able to access and download that Excel spreadsheet so you can put your numbers in and play around with it. It can be kind of motivating when you start seeing what some of these small changes can add up to in your business. Might give you that little bit of extra motivation to put into play. But let's move on to conversion rate. So conversion rate. Oh, you guys, right, you guys are gonna do the work first. Save me. So take 90 seconds now and just think about, so conversion rate is the moment when someone inquires about buying from us. You know, if you're a retail business, that's probably less of a in-depth process than if you're selling a large service or a large product that might take months to sell. But whatever your process is, just think about, what can you do to make it easy for someone to say yes? What can you do to make it easy for someone to say yes? All right. What do we got? Map out the process. So are you talking about for yourself or for the customer?
Well, you do it for yourself and the customer. If the customer
gives you the process, you're more likely to be more. Yep. Yeah, but it's a key one to do for yourself. So know your sales process. Because if you do have steps, you're going to have conversion rates all the way along that process. Oh, thank you. Measure. So it's a bit different, a product to a service, so mapping out how each works helps the customer, it helps, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, when they can see the steps, particularly if you've got a detail-oriented customer who likes to know how it all works, yeah, mapping that for them, really good idea.
Sure, maybe it's desirable, exclusive, whatever.
So use scarcity, yep. All right, clear pricing.
Communication.
Remove
any possible issues. The customer may have payment issues, so you have a payment plan.
Yeah, good.
Yep.
Plans. I'm going to put here, know the objections. Because you'll find in every business, there's usually 5 to 7 objections that come up, you know, again, 80% of the time. So you want to have, you know, if it's payment, then yeah, find a way to do payment plans or do something that allows you to overcome that objection. Yeah, good one, Diane, thank you. What was that one?
Trial or
test it. Trials, is that what you said? So are you talking about the puppy dog clothes? Take it home for a weekend and bring it back if you don't like it? So did you say trial?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, trial. Yeah, for sure. Yep.
Be engaging.
Yeah, engaging, I'll put empathy next to that. Yeah, when you can really understand what your customer's after and replay it back to them, yeah, that's gold. Pat?
Yeah, don't rely on them to contact you, get their details.
Yeah, absolutely. Drive the follow-up. Yeah, that's a really good one.
Ask for the sale.
Ask, I love that one. Yeah, the follow-up, yeah. Oh, yeah, we'll give you a call. Sure you will. How about I give you a call? What else?
Personalize.
Speak
their language.
Yes. Yeah, don't use jargon. Yep. Couple of really key ones still to come.
Incentive to convert?
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, an offer incentive, yeah. Anyone done sales training? Sales training. I think I've got that. Let me see what I've got up here. Number one measure, surprise, surprise. One of our clients was a used car dealership, and just by doing this strategy, by measuring it, in 2 quarters in a row, they increased their conversion rate on top of each other by 5% each quarter, doing nothing else, just measuring. That's all they did. Didn't change any scripting, didn't change anything, just measured it. And again, the awareness went up, and so the salespeople are thinking about it. And as soon as you think about it, your behavior changes. Testimonials and case studies, really important, depending on what you're selling, right? But when you can show that other people have been happy, that can go a long way. And building that into your sales process, making sure people come across that. What's that one again? Testimonials about referrals? Yeah, it can be. Yeah, for sure. So when you're asking for a testimonial, you mean? Yes, I see what you're saying. So letting people know, hey, 80% of our customers come from referral. Yeah, that's like social proof. Yeah, absolutely. But a great time to ask for a referral is when someone gives you a testimonial as well, right? Because they've just reinforced in their own mind why they like you. And so then it's time to ask for a referral. Authority and credibility, so that's just depending on, again, what it is that you're selling, helping them. You know, if you're selling something that there is lots of other people in the industry that aren't as good as you, you want to have ways of showing your credibility. Like if you've been in trade magazines or won awards or whatever it might be, you want to showcase that. If you've been published. So sales pathway, you brought that one up, Fiona, and I'll add to that sales speed. So there's the law of diminishing enthusiasm that says when someone starts out down the sales pathway, they're really excited and so on. But the longer that takes, the more that emotion dies. So you want to speed up as you get closer to the end of the pathway, not slow down. And that's where it becomes important to, as Pat said, drive the follow-up. And as you said, to know the objections. They're two key things to understand. I had that one today. So, and then guarantees. So one of the main reasons why people don't buy is because of perceived risk. And that perceived risk could be anything depending on what you're selling. So when you can identify what the major emotional risks are that people feel around your product and service, if you can wrap a guarantee around that and take it off the table, it can greatly increase conversion rate. Again, testimonials and guarantees are very powerful. And last one, which I was alluding to, was sales training. And this, I mean, depending on your identity and what you think around salespeople can greatly affect your ability to make sales. The best salespeople on the planet are professional problem solvers, and they know how to find out what the real problem is and then help that person to solve it. And they do it by asking great questions. So selling is very rarely about telling, right? The more you're telling, the less you are being effective. But if you can ask deep, thought-provoking questions of the other person, you'll find that you get them to think in new ways, you get them to discover what they really need, and they learn to trust you because you've done something for them that they haven't been able to do otherwise, and a sale becomes a lot easier. When you ask great questions, you don't need to close a sale, right? You might need to ask, okay, so should we move forward? But you don't need tricks and tactics to close a sale. Okay, let's look at our cheat sheet. Conversion rates. Certainly, you know, we talked about measuring. This is one that is relatively easy to measure. Because people either say yes or no, or they don't give you any answer. And we can measure that. So unless you've got zero customers, this will, you know, 99% of the time be the place to start before you start with lead generation. You want to make sure you've optimized conversion rate. You know, a 10% increase in conversion rate is a 10% increase in profits. Same with all of them, but conversion rate can just, it's often a quick and easy one to increase. So have a look there, circle two or three of your favorites. Okay, I might move on. We're getting close to time, but I do want to mention this book to you, the Revenue Growth Habit by Alex Goldfein. He covers off a lot of the things we're covering here tonight, but in there he's got lots of templates and tactical how-tos around things as well. And his whole methodology is that you don't need to spend a whole lot of time on this stuff, but if you do a couple of simple things every day or every week, you know, same methodology I'm talking, like small things done consistently, get results. But he's got some really good tools. Like he's got a great way of getting testimonials from customers that are really powerful through doing interviews. It's a good read. All right, lead generation. To keep us on time, I'm gonna go through these and we might we might just go straight to the cheat sheet, because we're going to spend a lot more time on lead generation in the Marketing Made Simple session. And honestly, lead generation is a really, it's a reasonably big topic. So I'm just going to share with you what I think are a sum of potentially the top five that you should be thinking about. And you've already covered off on a few of them already. Obviously, number one is measure, right? Know where your leads are coming from and what source they're coming by. I think it was Fiona mentioned back in overhead or margins to cut out the stuff that's not working. And we can only do that when we measure it, when we measure. The other interesting thing depends on how far you want to go down the rabbit hole here, but you might find that different lead generation strategies have different conversion rates because they bring different types of customers. Or that, you know, one channel brings a more educated customer versus another channel brings an uneducated customer, for instance. So it can help you get intel on that as well. Referrals, number one. If you don't have a proactive referral strategy right now, think about how you can put one in. For any service-based businesses, I highly, highly recommend Bob Berg's book, Endless Referrals. I've skipped ahead there. So, you know, we all probably get reactive referrals where people are coming to us through word of mouth, which is awesome. But take it one step further than having mechanisms that make it easy for people to introduce other people. And that may be a straight, flat-out ask. It may be having a simple thing like, hey, we're running this event. Why don't you bring someone who you think we might be able to help to that? Or it might be running open days and, you know, inviting customers to that. Whatever the mechanism might be, it might be a gift certificate that a client can give to another client for some free service or something. But have a mechanism or a way to make it easy for other people to introduce you. One other thing on that is that you'll generally find that there's a profile of customer that refers the best. Not every customer will be a great referrer, even if they're really happy with your product and service. So when you get a handle on who your connectors are, like the people that just are naturally connected and they love talking, like you know who these people are. They just love sharing information with other people. They're the easiest ones to identify and then to test your referral strategy on to see how it's going to work. Next one, strategic alliances and partnerships. So there are other businesses out there that don't compete with you that share your ideal customer. So how can you align with them, work together to, you know, help each other to introduce each other to, you know, to the more ideal clients? And there's often a number of ways to do this. Now, the caveat here is that these sort of relationships do take time to develop, and they're not necessarily as easy as sitting down and saying, hey, let's just, you know, refer to each other. Because sometimes when we do that, you sit down with the best of intentions, but then everyone gets back to their business and, you know, the phone starts ringing, emails come in. So having some formal mechanism around it is helpful. And in my book, I talk more about it, and I even link to a system that you can use to as a framework on how to develop these partnerships. But having intention behind them and selecting the right partners is really important. But these two strategies can cost $0 to put into place. And can be, you know, two of the most powerful strategies because both of them are bringing highly qualified leads into your business that already come with a sense of trust. SEO and paid search, you know, there's a lot to be done here in today's world. If you're looking to get new customers and you don't have a web presence, then you probably should. And if you don't understand how to be relevant on your website, you probably should look into that. You don't need to be an expert yourself, but know enough so when you do hire someone, you know that you're getting the right job done. And paid search is awesome because it's very measurable and you can turn it on and off very quickly. So again, not for everyone, but certainly a strategy to be thinking about. Fiona, you've probably got something to expand on that one. If you need to know more about that, talk to Fiona. Then learn how to write effective ads and offers because there is a science and a psychology behind it. I can recommend a couple of good books is Scientific Advertising and My Life in Advertising. They're two great books written by direct marketers who spent millions and millions of dollars of other people's money learning what works and what doesn't and then wrote a book about it. So when you understand the psychology about how people make decisions and what prevents them, you can write much more effective ads. And we are going to expand on that in the marketing session as well. So with that one, while I flip over to or hand these out, in the marketing session, we're also going to talk about this, which is the marketing vehicle checklist. Again, not an exhaustive, and you'll have to come out to the marketing session to get a copy of that one. But it's not an exhaustive list, but it's more of a framework for how to think about what you should be doing for marketing. And it goes through and, you know, lists the major vehicles, as we call them, for lead generation and other forms of marketing, and sort of ask you around, what are you currently using, what's worked, what hasn't, what's used in the past, what do you think you should be using or could be using, and then a way to go through and prioritize them so you can start to think about how to implement things. And again, in the marketing session, we're going to talk about how to develop marketing calendars to keep a rhythm around it. So we'll go into a lot more detail in that session. But take a look at that last cheat sheet you've got there, and again, circle two or three things that you think look like they could work for your business or something you should be thinking about. So I'm going to run through just some summary actions now of how you want to think about this to apply what we've gone through. And, you know, while we've gone through a lot of different strategies and you've got the list there of different things you can do, you know, hopefully that will serve you for a long time to come. But really, as I said at the beginning, the takeaway I want you to have is more around the methodical approach of doing small things and doing them consistently rather than trying to just to go out and, okay, let's go and increase our profit tomorrow. So what do we do? So the first thing is to try and get the most accurate numbers you possibly can for your six-point model, and start where you've got numbers. If you can't get accurate numbers easily, then just ballpark something, but get yourself a starting point. The other thing is, and we haven't talked about this so far, is model how you want the numbers to be. So on the first session, we talked about profit model. I asked you to have a profit goal, and then we developed that profit first budget. You can do the same thing with this model. Put the profit in that you want to have and then work it backwards. So you can say, okay, to get there, we've got to have this many customers. Our average spend has got to be this amount. So to get that, we've got to have this many customers. We've got to have this conversion rate, and you can work it backwards. You can also, if you love spreadsheets, you can see what it looks like compounding it year over year. You run it 1 year, then you run it the next year, then the year after. That starts to get pretty exciting, if you like spreadsheets. So once you've modeled it out and you've got your own numbers, decide which areas present the best opportunity, because you'll look at it and you go, for sure, conversion rate, we're doing nothing there, that's where we should go. Or you look at retention, you go, we need to start measuring that. That's an obvious one. Whatever it is, you'll know where to start. Brainstorm your ideas, which you've already started tonight. Pick three things to test in the next 90 days. So test them, measure them as best you can, get a feel for if they're working or not. Execute it, measure it, rinse and repeat. Do it again, next 90 days. Then again, the next 90 days. Then again, the next 90 days. When we get to the session talking about planning, you're going to see this is a part of it, okay? Picking our six-point model strategies for the next 90 days. So you've always got something you're working on, you're thinking about those key drivers in your business. Folks, that's a wrap. I hope there has been something there for you out of the session. And I hope you take away and put some things in place. And the recording is there if you want to go back and watch it again. And obviously all the downloads are there for you as well. If you want the Excel spreadsheet, you'll be able to download that from the website where the video is. So thank you very much for coming out, and we'll see you at the next one.